Hello students, in this part, let us study about a very interesting property shown by a liquid at rest called surface tension. We observe various wonderful phenomena around us, like insects walking on a steady water surface or the liquid level in a capillary tube immersed in a liquid either rises or falls down, or the soap bubbles, they always assume a spherical shape. All these phenomena arise due to surface tension. To understand what is surface tension on the basis of molecular theory, let us revise certain terms. Cohesive force. The intermolecular forces of attraction between the molecules of the same substance are cohesive forces. Adhesive force. The intermolecular forces of attraction between molecules of different substances are adhesive forces, and cohesive forces are always stronger than the adhesive forces. Range of molecular force. The maximum distance from a molecule up to which the molecular force is effective is called as range of molecular force. Sphere of influence. An imaginary sphere drawn with a molecule at its center and radius equal to the molecular range is called as sphere of influence. Surface film. The surface layer of a liquid with thickness equal to range of intermolecular force is termed as surface film. Surface tension is a property by virtue of which a liquid surface behaves like a stretched membrane, as if it is under the action of certain inward pull. In order to understand its origin, let us see what happens inside a liquid at molecular level. As shown in figure, PQRS is the surface film of the liquid. Consider the molecule A well inside the liquid. It is equally attracted in all directions by the other liquid molecules. Hence, the net force acting on it is zero. Now consider another molecule B lying inside the surface film in such a way that small part of its sphere of influence lies above the liquid surface. This molecule experiences less upward force due to air molecules than the downward force due to liquid molecules. For molecule C, half of its sphere of influence lies above the liquid surface. The resultant downward force on such a molecule is maximum. So all such molecules lying in the liquid film will experience a net downward force and the potential energy of them will be high than those lying at the interior of the liquid. Now, for any system to be stable, the potential energy should be minimum. For the surface film to have minimum energy, the number of molecules in the surface film should be less. Thus, the surface film tends to have minimum surface area. This is nothing but surface tension. From the previous discussion, we have understood that if we draw an imaginary line in a liquid surface, it will experience some tangential force. Hence, we can define surface tension as the tangential force acting per unit length on both sides of an imaginary line drawn in the free surface of liquid. Its SI unit is Newton per meter or Joule per meter square. Now, how this other unit comes, that you will understand in the next slide. The CGS unit can be written as dyne per centimeter or erg per centimeter square. Here is a data table which gives you the values of surface tension for certain liquids. As you go through it, you can see that mercury has the maximum surface tension, whereas soap solution has a minimum surface tension here. Also, previously we have seen that when a molecule is in the interior of the liquid, its potential energy is minimum. In order to bring it in the surface of a liquid, we need to do some work against the net inward pull. This work is stored in the form of potential energy. This extra energy held by liquid surface is called surface energy. The unit of surface energy is joule. Relation between surface tension and surface energy. Consider a rectangular frame of wire P'PSS'. It is fitted with a movable arm QR as shown in the figure. This frame is dipped in a soap solution and then taken out. A film of soap solution will be formed within the boundaries PQRS of the frame. Each arm of the frame experiences an inward force due to the film. Under the action of this force, the movable arm QR moves towards side PS so as to decrease the area of the film. Thus, force acting on the side QR of length L due to surface tension is F is equal to T into 2L. Since the surface has two surfaces, upper and lower one, the factor of 2 is there. If movable arm is moved through a distance dx against this force, work done is equal to force into displacement, that is T into 2L times dx. But 2L dx is increase in surface area of the two faces of the film. Hence, the work done is equal to T into dA. This work done is stored as the surface energy. Thus, surface energy is equal to T times dA, or we can say that surface tension is surface energy per unit area. Thus, the other SI unit for surface tension is joule per meter square. When a liquid surface comes in contact with a solid surface, it forms a meniscus which can be either convex or concave depending upon the solid-liquid pair. In order to understand these different shapes of meniscus, we define angle of contact. Angle of contact is defined as the angle between tangent drawn to the free surface of the liquid and surface of solid at that point of contact measured within the liquid. When meniscus is convex, the angle of contact is obtuse, and when meniscus is concave, angle of contact is acute. The angle of contact for different liquid-solid pairs are given in the adjacent data table. Different solid-liquid pairs assume different shapes of meniscus, so the angle of contact changes. The reason for this lies in the net effect of cohesive forces between liquid molecules and adhesive forces between liquid and solid molecules. In order to understand this, let us consider three different cases. Case 1, concave meniscus and acute angle of contact. Consider a molecule A on the surface of the liquid near the wall of the container. This molecule experiences both cohesive as well as adhesive forces. Here, the net adhesive force is much greater than the net cohesive force. Thus, the resultant force is directed inside the solid. For equilibrium or stability of a liquid surface, the net force acting on the molecule must be normal to the liquid surface. Thus, all the liquid molecules near the wall pile up against the solid boundary so that the tangent to the liquid surface is perpendicular to AR. Thus, the meniscus assumes concave shape and the angle of contact is acute. case 2, convex meniscus, obtuse angle of contact. Here, the net adhesive force is less than the net cohesive force. Thus, the resultant force is directed inside the liquid. Hence, the liquid meniscus assumes convex shape and angle of contact is obtuse. Case 3, no meniscus or plain meniscus and zero angle of contact. Here, there is no cohesive force. The net force, therefore, is nothing but the net adhesive force which is directed inside the solid. Hence, the liquid level is plain and the angle of contact is zero. Further, let us consider the case where angle of contact is 90 degree. According to theory, for angle of contact to be 90 degree, the cohesive force AC should be exactly at 45 degree with either of the surfaces so that the resultant force AR is exactly vertical. This happens in case of pure water taken in silver. If we apply law of parallelogram, then we can conclude that here the net adhesive force AP is equal to net cohesive force AC upon root 2. With this, we can conclude two conditions for angle of contact to be acute and angle of contact to be obtuse, as shown in the adjacent table. For acute angle of contact, the net adhesive force should be greater than net cohesive force by root 2, and for obtuse angle of contact, the net adhesive force should be less than the net cohesive force upon root 2. This knowledge is important from MCQ point of view. Another interesting manifestation of surface tension is shape of liquid drops on a solid surface. When a small amount of a liquid is dropped on a plain solid surface, the liquid will either spread on the surface or will form droplets on the surface, which depends on the relative values of surface tension between different interfaces between solid, liquid and air. Let theta be the angle of contact for the given solid liquid pair. T1 is force due to surface tension at the liquid solid interface. T2 be the force due to surface tension at the air solid interface. And T3 be the force due to surface tension at the air liquid interface. At equilibrium, horizontal components are balanced. That is, T2 is equal to T1 plus T3 cos theta. Therefore, cos theta is equal to T2 minus T1 upon T3. Now let us consider different cases for relative values of T1, T2 and T3. Case 1, T2 is greater than T1 and T2 minus T1 is less than T3. For this case, cos theta is positive, which implies that angle of contact is acute. Case 2, T2 is less than T1 and T1 minus T2 is less than T3, which implies that cos theta is negative and hence angle of contact is obtuse. Case 1 is shown in the first diagram. Case 2 is shown in the second diagram. Case 3, T2 minus T1 is equal to T3, which implies that cos theta is equal to 1 and hence angle of contact is 0. Case 4, if T2 minus T1 is greater than T3, it implies that cos theta is greater than 1, which is not possible. Let us see what are the factors affecting the angle of contact. The value of the angle of contact depends on various factors like the nature of liquid and solid in contact, impurities present in the liquid and temperature of the liquid. Any increase in the temperature of a liquid decreases its angle of contact. It also depends on medium above free surface of liquid. Now let us go through the effect of impurity and temperature on surface tension. When soluble substance such as common salt is dissolved in water, the surface tension of water increases. When a sparingly soluble substance such as phenol or detergent is mixed with water, surface tension of water decreases. Whereas when insoluble impurity like dust is added to water, surface tension of water decreases. Let us see the effect of temperature. With increase in temperature, surface tension decreases. It means that as the temperature decreases, the value of surface tension increases. Let us study excess pressure across the free surface of a liquid. The direction of the resultant force of surface tension acting on a molecule on the liquid surface determines the shape of the meniscus and the relative pressure on both sides of the free surface of a liquid. Consider three liquids with different shapes of meniscus. Let molecule A is just above and molecule B is just below the free surface of liquid. Case 1. For plain meniscus, the resultant force due to surface tension is 0. Atmospheric pressure is acting vertically downward. So, the pressure at A is just equal to pressure at B. The atmospheric pressure is acting vertically downward in the other two cases also. For convex meniscus, the resultant force due to surface tension is vertically downward. Hence, the pressure at point A, that is on the convex side of meniscus, is less than the pressure at B, that is on the concave side of meniscus. As shown in the third diagram, for concave meniscus, the resultant force due to surface tension is vertically upward. Because of that, pressure at A, that is on the concave side, is larger than the pressure at B, that is the convex side of the meniscus. To calculate the excess pressure inside a liquid drop. Liquid drops and small bubbles are spherical in shape because the force of surface tension tries to minimize the surface area of the liquid. A bubble or drop does not collapse because the pressure inside is greater than the pressure outside. To calculate this excess pressure, consider a spherical drop of radius r. Let the radius of the drop increases by a small factor delta r. The initial surface area of the drop A1 is given by 4 pi r square, whereas the final surface area A2 is equal to 4 pi times r plus delta r bracket square. Thus, the increase in surface area of the drop is dA is equal to A2 minus A1, which is equal to 8 pi r times delta r. Here we have neglected the factor delta r square being very small. Work done in increasing this surface area against the force of surface tension is stored as the surface energy. Therefore, dw is equal to T times change in surface area is equal to T times 8 pi r delta r, where T is the surface tension. Let us call this as equation 1. This work done is also equal to the product of force due to excess pressure and the displacement delta r. The force due to excess pressure is equal to excess pressure into surface area of the drop, that is Pi minus Po into 4 pi r square. Therefore, work done can also be given by the other equation, pi minus po into 4 pi r square into delta r. Let us call this as equation 2. Equating both these equations, T into 8 pi r delta r is equal to pi minus po times 4 pi r square into delta r gives us the expression for excess pressure as pi minus po is equal to twice T upon r. This is the expression for excess pressure inside a liquid drop, which is also called as Laplace law for spherical membrane. In case of a soap bubble, there are two free surfaces, the inner one and the outer one. Hence, the change in surface area will be double than the previous case. Therefore, in the first equation, we get dW is equal to T times 16 pi r delta r, and the second equation remains the same as pi minus po is equal to 4 pi r square delta r. If you equate these new equations, then for soap bubble, we get the expression for excess pressure as pi minus po is equal to 4 times T upon r. Another interesting manifestation of surface tension is the capillary action or capillarity. The phenomenon of rise or fall of a liquid inside a capillary tube when it is dipped in the liquid is called capillarity. When such a capillary is dipped in a liquid, two effects can be observed. Either the liquid level rises in the capillary or the liquid level falls down. Let us first consider capillary fall. A capillary tube dipped in a liquid which does not wet the solid. For example, mercury glass pair. Here, the shape of mercury meniscus in the capillary is upper convex and there is fall in the mercury level inside the capillary tube. Why does it happen so? In order to understand this, let us consider four points A, B, C and D as shown in the figure. Point A is just above the convex surface inside the capillary. Point B is just below the convex surface again inside the capillary, whereas point C and D are just above and below the plane surface outside the capillary tube. Let PA, PB, PC and PD be the values of pressure at the points A, B, C and D respectively. Now let us compare the values of pressure at these four points. First, PB is greater than PA because, as seen previously, pressure on the concave side of a meniscus is always greater than that on the convex side. Second, PA is equal to PC because both these points are at the same level and are in the same medium. Next, PC is equal to PD because both these points are on either sides of the plane surface of the liquid outside the capillary tube. The second and third observation leads to the conclusion that PA is equal to PD. From this set of observation, we can conclude that PB is greater than PD, that is, pressure inside the capillary in the interior of the liquid is greater than pressure outside the capillary. To achieve equilibrium, hence, the liquid will flow from inside to outside the capillary and hence the meniscus will fall down. To study about capillary rise, consider a capillary tube dipped in a liquid which wets the solid. For example, water glass pair. Here, the shape of water meniscus in the capillary is upper concave and the water level rises inside the capillary tube. To understand this phenomenon, let us again compare the pressure values at four different points A, B, C, D, just like the previous case. Here, PB is less than PA because the pressure on the concave side has to be greater than that on convex side. As seen in the previous case, PA is equal to PC and PC is equal to PD, which implies that PA is equal to PD. From this set of observations, we can say that PB is less than PD. To achieve equilibrium, liquid from outside will flow inside the capillary and hence the water level will rise. Having understood about the phenomenon of capillary action, now let us see on which factors does this rise or fall depend and obtain the necessary formula for the same. The expression can be obtained by two ways. Method 1, using pressure difference. As shown in the figure, let H is height of water column, big R be the radius of curvature of meniscus, small r be the horizontal distance between the center of the imaginary circle on meniscus and vertical wall, and theta be the angle between the two. Pressure due to liquid column is equal to h rho g, whereas the pressure difference between the points A and B due to concavity of the meniscus is 2t upon r. Equating these two pressure values, we can write h rho g is equal to 2t upon big R. Let us substitute big R is equal to r upon cos theta from the geometry of the figure. Therefore, h rho g is equal to 2t upon r upon cos theta, which gives you the necessary expression for h as 2t cos theta upon r rho g. Narrower the tube, the greater is the height to which the liquid will rise or fall. The another method to obtain the expression for capillary rise or fall is using forces. Here, rise of water inside a capillary is against gravity. Hence, weight of the liquid column must be balanced by an equal and opposite force due to surface tension. As shown in the figure, that upward force is equal to Ft cos theta. Now, the length of liquid in contact inside the capillary is twice pi r, the circumference of the circle. Hence, force due to surface tension is 2 pi r into t, and its vertical component, which is Ft cos theta, is equal to 2 pi r t cos theta. Now the downward force, which is nothing but the weight of the liquid column, W is equal to mg, which in turn is equal to density into volume into g. Hence, the downward force is pi r square h rho g. If we equate both these forces, it gives us the necessary expression for h as 2t cos theta upon r rho g. Here we have completed our discussion about all the aspects related to surface tension. Now let us go through two interesting situations which are important from numericals point of view. As we know, any change in surface area is accompanied by change in surface energy. Let us go through two different situations. First one, when there is an increase in surface area, work is done against surface tension. Hence, surface energy increases. Let a single drop of a liquid of radius big R breaks into n number of small droplets of radius small r. In order to keep the volume constant, let us equate the volume of the single big drop to the total volume of those small droplets, which gives us the relation between small r and big R. So the radius of that small droplet can be expressed in terms of the radius of the bigger drop as small r is equal to n raised to minus 1/3 times r. And accordingly, the increase in surface area will be equal to 4 pi r square in bracket n raised to 1/3 minus 1. So if we know the radius of the single big drop and if we know in how many tiny droplets it has been broken, we can calculate the work done in the process using the formula 4 pi times big R square into the surface tension in bracket cube root of n minus 1. The another interesting situation is about decrease in surface area. Here, work is done by the surface tension and hence energy will be liberated. Let us consider exactly reverse process of what we have seen in the previous case. N small droplets combine together to form a single big drop of radius big R. Again, the volume is kept constant. So, using the fact, we can express the radius of that single drop in terms of the radius of those small droplets as big R is equal to cube root of n times small r. Let us calculate the decrease in surface area as delta A is equal to 4 pi r square in bracket n minus n raised to 2/3, and hence the energy liberated during this process is equal to change in area into surface tension. So this is the necessary formula to calculate the energy released in this process.